Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another episode of Boxing Rampage, episode 21.
We're legal now.
We're legal. I'm your host, JC.
We're here with Flacco. All
right, and we have some suds. We're not going to promote anyone because they don't pay us.
Remember, we do this for free.
For free.
And today we're going to be talking about the Lomachenko on the card.
Yeah.
It was UK invasion, the Ukrainian invasion,
DBZ.
Basically. Yep. Awesome fights.
Yeah, so yeah, we'll talk about the reviews last week, and then we'll talk about the fights coming up this week, and we're celebrating Barrera.
Awesome.
So let's start with the other cards. I believe it was Usyk, Oleksandr Usyk versus,
Michael Hunter.
Michael Hunter, a.k.a. Big Sean. I saw the fight. I don't know, do you want to give your take first, or I'll just give my take?
Yeah, go ahead.
Michael Hunter, a lot of heart, very awkward fighting style. I felt that he engaged unnecessarily sometimes. It's just a very, very awkward, very sloppy type style. I feel like he wasn't putting leather directly on Usyk, and he looked really good. Head movement was great. You know, I think Roy Jones was saying, he was rubbernecking. He was, you know, he was moving the neck, everything like this, just going back. So. That was really good, but eventually it caught up to him. Usyk was able to get the best of him most of the rounds, and obviously showed a lot of heart from him, but Usyk was a lot more superior. I felt that he was going to go for the KO, but it was a no-brainer. He won, but I would like to see Michael Hunter fight again. He looks like he's a fighter that I wouldn't mind rooting for. I felt like a lot of emotion because it was parts in the fight I felt he was going to get knocked out, and you know, lo and behold, I think they count that one knockdown when he fell on his butt.
Yeah,
the ropes.
The rope hold him up.
So I saw that and I was like, oh man, I was just edge of my seat because it was like, you know, I didn't think he was going to win the fight, but I just kept thinking he was going to get knocked out, and you know, eventually he didn't. I mean, he lost the fight, but it was just, I felt compelled to kind of root for him to stay in the fight. But Usyk did what he normally does. I felt that he started off really slow. He started out really slow in the fight, and he picked it up later on. I think after the fifth round is when I saw him just, you know, connecting everything more, putting a lot more pressure. I think by like the eighth round, I saw Usyk, like from rounds five to eight, I felt that he was really trying to put him away, but it just didn't come together. And I felt at that point, it's like, you know what, I'm just gonna win the rounds, throw more punches, look like the better fighter, and just did that. That's all I got to say about that. All
right, if you ask me one word to describe Hunter, I would say amateur. He was putting in a really nice combination at the beginning, was boxing really beautiful, and actually gave him almost like the first three rounds. But he was not sitting on those punches, and he was not hurting Usyk, not even to hurt him in a way. Basically, what you want to do is establish your power or some kind of power or pop, so you could let the other guy know, hey, I could hurt you too, I'm here, you know? And he wasn't doing that. He was just tapping him, and just collecting points like in an amateur style. Usyk did not impress me. Honestly, HBO trying to sell this guy as the next big thing. Honestly, I'm still not. Maybe he's still green, but then again, the guy is over 30 years old, I believe, if I'm mistaken. But honestly, I don't buy it. You know, they want to make him like the next Ivan the Holyfield, who's going to move up in to heavyweight and is going to become a champion there. I don't see it. The guys have a lot of flaws. He, like you said, he takes long to get into second gear. And basically, I'm not impressed with the guy. He got the job done, but similar to his first fight, if you're trying to make a big name in the U.S., it's really hard to root for the guy. He's not, you know, he's not committed to his punches. His corner just suddenly break the guy. I don't understand this, but hey, I mean, honestly, I'm not impressed. The guy who I was impressed with was the other Oleksandr, Gvozdyk.
G-Man.
I'm a truly new fan of Gvozdyk. This guy,
Gvozdyk.
Yeah. Oleksandr Gvozdyk.
Gvozdyk. Yeah. Fuck, we'll go with that.
Yeah, that's what how they were saying it on the
Gvozdyk.
Gvozdyk. So,
Glassdick.
So, guy put up a great performance and broke
Yunieski
Gonzalez. A fight that a lot of people that I respect in boxing was picking Gonzalez.
He walked in there real tough, man. He had the little, little mohawk. He was like, yeah, I'm going to...
He was
hitting him with the punches.
Yeah, Gonzalez was a bigger guy, but Vasyl put a great combination and really beautiful with his skills and his movement. And this guy moved. And I'm not saying that he could be Kovalev or Ward, but he would give them both great fights. And I think he's up there. A good fight for him, I think, is Barrera next. If he could get that, he could get a Joe Smith. I could see him beating Joe Smith. I could see him beating or giving competition. I can't say beating as of now, because this guy's still really green, basically. He only got like 10, 12 fights. But he's a top contender, and I could put him right now as top 10 on the light heavyweight. The guy impressed me a lot. I'm a completely new fan of this guy. I'm going to follow him. I fell in love with the guy. The guy could box.
His game was tight.
Beautiful performance by him. And I think...
I think he's got better footwork than Usyk, of course.
Yeah, definitely. And I think he stole the show, in my opinion, because...
He got the job done, too.
Yeah, Vasyl Lomachenko did what we all thought he was gonna do with, basically. So I give him a lot of props. He did great, but this guy just completely dominated and broke a guy who we thought was a top 10 contender at a light heavyweight, which Yunieski Gonzalez. What do you think about that fight?
No, I feel the same way. I feel that he performed really well. He's very solid. Paced it well, and pretty much I just felt the pressure was just too much for Gonzalez, and he broke him down. But it's something I feel the same way about. It's one of those things. I was just looking on the phone. I think he would be a good opponent.
He's still
green.
Beterbiev also is. He haven't been fighting. He's not active enough. I don't know what's wrong. He's been getting injured. And he just having problem getting fights. He is a monster. And if you ask me who I ought to pick right now fighting next, it'll be a really tough fight for both of them, I believe. The thing about boxing is that you gotta be out there. You gotta be active in order for you to gain fans. You know, for people to follow you. And he also not even for that.
Just watching my back, man.
it should be fine. It's just a girl. So basically, if you want to stay relative and in shape, you know, you got to stay active. He's not fighting. He was off for a while for injury, and then came back for like one or two fights, and now he went away all over again. So that'll be a great fight. I also like the guy, but it's hard to like guys when they're not active. And
yeah,
that guys like Mikey Garcia, who I was a completely fan. Back then, he broke my heart, man. And now, you know, he's gaining it a little bit back again. But you know, it's hard. I still got that resentment in the back of the bottom of my heart, bro. You was inactive for like 2.5 years.
And what about also mentioned too? And I know we're going off topic here, but I mentioned Omar Figueroa, man. He gave us great fights, and he hasn't fought in some time. So
yeah, I don't know. He probably is committed to his studies. A good kid. He got a lot of heart. You know, he'll impress you. You know, sometimes when you think he don't got enough, he'll bring more. But yeah, you know, the guy haven't been making weight lately, and he been fighting from all the weights from almost middleweight basically, or junior middleweight, to 140. So I don't know what weight he is in right now. I mean, the guy he likes to eat. What can I say? I love tacos too, but as much as I eat, I don't gain. But going back to the topics, you want to move to the main event?
Yeah, the Lomachenko fight, man. He fought Jason Sosa. Man, it was just Sosa. I don't know. I can't embellish this, man. I don't feel that he did anything. I mean, there were some points where I felt he was dodging Lomachenko's jab, but it was totally one-sided. Totally one-sided. I don't, you know, to give him two rounds is too much.
I didn't even find him out.
Lomachenko just completely disassembled him and did it slowly. Established the range, set the jab. Beautiful footwork. Man, this guy was dancing circles around the ring, Lomachenko. But he did what he always does. And with a guy like Lomachenko, it's easy to get used to that kind of talent and expect a lot from him. Even I remember Max Kellerman was asking him, hey, so what's next for you? Who can we expect to fight? Or who, or something, the question was something along the lines of, who do you want to fight that would be a challenge for you? Because, I mean, you know, they keep mentioning the Salido fight. I'm pretty sure it was a rematch him, but obviously he mentioned the whole Mikey Garcia thing, but he's just too good, man. That was no contest, that fight. I mean, what do you see? Same thing?
Yeah, basically, we saw two guys are at different levels, you know. He will be at 130 pounds. He's at the elite level, Lomachenko is, and
Jason Sosa.
Jason Sosa is what, a C-plus level fighter, B-minus, you say?
Mm-hmm.
The only thing that makes Sosa a big name is his heart, basically.
Yeah.
And even Lomachenko was able to break that, you know. One thing that I could tell, though, I don't understand why HBO would keep putting their moms in the front. Guys, don't be inviting your moms to
Curtis. Yeah, what did you say? Curtis Stevens' mom?
Yeah, Curtis Stevens' mom. Sosa's mom. Come on, man. That breaks your heart, man. You know, it's different. Like, I got a son, and he could run around and basically break a leg. And I'm like, he'll be fine, you know. But my wife, on the other hand, she's like, going crazy. And that's how women are. Yeah, I don't think that, you know.
It reminds you of that scene in Rocky IV with Apollo Creed's wife.
Yeah.
They just kill him in the ring and she starts freaking out. I was like, oh my, that's what these people must feel like. They're just freaking out.
Yeah, it's that I believe they shouldn't do that. I mean, I understand maybe if you get a win, you know, hey, Ma, you want to come watch the fight. But when disassembled like that, like Sosa did, it's really hard to see.
It could have been worse.
I know it could have been. And I'm glad the corner stopped it, but we could have seen another Nomas. He could have just waved it off. I mean, but he showed heart, you know, and that's what make him a fighter.
There's no point in finishing that fight knowing that there's no way you were going to come back and there's no way he was going to knock him out. Because even in the telecast, they kept saying that Sosa would land punches a punch at a time, but he wasn't able to land combinations on him. And with a guy like Lomachenko, I think the only thing that's going to beat Lomachenko is his age. Unless a guy like him continues to fight and his footwork is insane. I don't see anybody touching him because, like I said, his footwork is really good. So that was pretty much last week's cards. And then this week we have the Salomon Barrera is fighting. This is pretty much at this point it's a tune-up fight. Paul Parker. He's fighting. Paul Parker's record stands at 8-1, and that one loss was by knockout, and has 4 KOs. For me, it's a look good, stay busy fight for Salomon Barrera. I just think they're just trying to keep him fresh for someone else, whether it be, you know, another fighter. Obviously, Barrera's one loss was to Andre Ward, which is his best showcase fight, and then obviously Barrera had the his fight. But yeah, I see that being one side as well. I think that fight's gonna be on. HBO Latino. Yeah, and then from there, obviously in Scotland, you have the Ricky Burns fight versus Julius Ondongo. Who do you have for that fight?
What can I say?
Well, how do you see it going before we even...
The problem about it, this fight is, and look at it this way, Ondongo is a guy who came out an impressive one-punch knockout in the first round versus the previous champion. You can find that. But this guy...
Edward Trojanovski.
Yeah, Edward. Impressive.
From
Russia. For me, was one of the candidates of knockout of the year for best year. Impressive. But... Ricky Burns has never been stopped.
I can't even be here, man. Like, you babysitting him?
He
running a daycare center?
Nah, I'm talking here. Come on, man. Give me time. So basically, Terrence Crawford couldn't knock out Ricky Burns. The guy went 12 with him. Burns is a guy who got a chin, and you know that in his hometown, Ricky Burns had been favored against Beltran, who we all believe Beltran won that fight. I see Ondongo maybe edging the card, but getting robbed. I could see that happening. Because Ricky Burns, in his last fight, I overestimated and believe he was a little bit old. he's getting old, and he showed some kind of fatigue lately. He's mm-hmm. not the same guy he used to be, but mm-hmm. I'll stick to that. I think Ndongo will win the fight, but he will get robbed in the cards.
I'm going to go out on a limb. I'm going to say Ndongo wins the fight either by way of the judges or by knockout. There's something about him that just catches my eye, being that he doesn't look like a strong guy, but I think he generates most of his power from a long range. So where with a fighter like that, I mean, on paper it says they're the same size. I think they're both 5'10", from what I see here on BoxRec. It says, they're both 5'10". He is just a 1.5-inch advantage as far as reach, and obviously Ricky Burns has a 70-inch reach advantage. But the way Ndongo fights, it seems like he's a ranger guy. He looks like more flexible. It looks like he's able to use his legs and his body better. To where Ricky Burns, I don't think he's as mobile as Ndongo. I think it's going to be an upset. Obviously, it's going to be his hometown. It'll be an upset.
Yeah, that's the only reason it's an upset, because I believe Ndongo could outbox
Like I said, there's something special about his style. He's a southpaw, too. So, I mean, it's one of those things to where the fight, I think his range is really going to bother Burns. And obviously, with a southpaw stance, he's going to pepper the shit out of his face and go around him. But yeah, there's something I've said about, I've seen Ndongo fight, and just the way he fights, his ranginess, is something that I feel is going to give him problems. Something tells me that'll be good. But that's my pick. Ndongo, either by unanimous decision or a late stoppage, early stoppage. It could be a stoppage, but I see it as it's going to be one of those long range bombs, and Ndongo throws it and puts Ricky Burns away if it goes that route. But yeah, that's my pick on that.
I don't disagree. I mean, maybe the whole knockout. Maybe you are a little going on the limb, because
well, then again, I have that you're going to be in. So
and Ndongo does only have 11 knockouts, I believe. He pack a punch, but I mean, I don't see him knocking out Ricky Burns. I see him edging it, though. But then again, will we get the decision in a hometown cooking? I really doubt it. But
I mean, Ricky Burns is obviously the more experienced.
Yeah, he's
fighter.
A more experienced fighter. He's he's been in more wars, though, and that's why I favor Ndongo, the hungry lion, basically at this point.
For me, I kind of see with all due respect. I see Ricky Burns' record is kind of like Kell Brook's, man. He's got some shady numbers on this. Like, he's got one guy, Ernie Smith, 07, 13 wins, 117 losses. That's insane. You got a guy here, Frederick Bonafide, beat him by TKO, 33 wins, 29 knockouts. Billy Smith, 12 wins, 63 knockouts. Gregory Giamperica in 08, May of 08. 8 wins, 37 knockouts. So it kind of looks like a Kell Brook type record. First guy he fought, 7 wins, 29 knockouts. 29 losses is what I meant to say. 18 KOs. That guy was, they didn't even have a picture of the guy. They got another guy here, the Ernie Smith guy with 41 losses. 19. Oh my, I'm sorry, I apologize, people. It's not 42. It's 142 losses. And he's got a picture. Look him up, guys. Ernie, E-R-N-I-E, Smith, common spelling, 13 wins, 1 knockout. I mean, Paulie's got a better record than this guy. He's like 142 losses and then 19 losses by KO. So it's like a lot of suspect. That 41 looks padded. It looks like Canelo before he came to the States.
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
One time in a career of a boxer, do you understand that you should retire? When you retire, I'm going to come up.
You know when the coach gives you those talks? Never give up, son. Always keep fighting. Because at some point, you got to look at that shit. Your wife got to tell her, hey, honey, you gotta stop it. You quit it.
You need guys like this to build up Ricky Burns and Kell Brook, I guess. I don't know. So,
And all fighters in the UK.
Yeah, and I believe those are the worth mentioned fights for this coming week.
Yeah, let's move on from that, from the fights next this week. So what do you want to talk about now? Do you want to jump into the whole Kell Brook and Errol Spence thing, or you want to
let's talk about Southern former calling now Javante the Tech.
Hold me back. He's escorting him out of there. He's like, get your hands off me.
Basically, Davis is from
Gervonta
Davis. He's from Baltimore.
Yeah.
So, you know, the card was in Washington right there. Right next door.
Right
next door, basically. So he was there, and which is the Lomachenko on the card, I mean card, basically. So I guess, basically, in the backstages, they met up, and Devin Farmer demanded the fight, and, you know, people was, like, all over him, and he tried to get a little bit aggressive. They were holding him, and...
What was that? I'm sorry. This was dumb. Keep going. You were saying?
So, I guess... Tevin Farmer demanded the fight, and Davis said he would give it to him. And, like, then again, the next day, Adrian Broner got involved. But that, for me, is solo promotion, I guess. It's not... I don't think that's legit. Because he called Floyd a bitch, and then the next day he was with Floyd dancing to Macarena and going live on Instagram.
If you're wondering why we're looking to the right, is we have
the kids.
Some folks bothering over here. They want attention.
Yeah.
We're giving us your attention this time. I don't know, man. The way I see that fight, if it were to happen, obviously they have to get past their opponents. I see Tevin Farmer winning, man. Tevin Farmer has sick defense, man. Like, and obviously the best opponent Gervonta Davis fought was Pedraza, Jose Pedraza, and Pedraza wasn't himself that fight. That jab didn't come out that he has.
It's not bad.
I mean,
he was struggling making the weight as well.
I had a long layoff too.
Yeah.
So I mean, you know, it's one of those things. I really don't want to cut that. I really don't want to pause the video, but I may be forced to pause the video. But if that fight were to ever happen, I feel Tevin Farmer would win. The defense would show. You got to think, Gervonta Davis is a guy that he likes to attack to the body. He likes to get in close, and that's where he does his best work, real in close. And a guy like Tevin Farmer works really well from the inside. That's where his defense comes out, and he's got a really good jab. So, I mean, a guy like Farmer, especially with the movement he has, would give him fits of all kinds of fits. And I feel that Farmer, to me, is a more experienced fighter. But that's pretty much one of the things. But when that fight, if it does happen, then obviously we'll be here to cover it. But anything else going on in the whole rumor mill?
Let me touch up on that. I totally agree. I think Tevin Farmer will be a step up on when it comes to skill. Tevin been dropped and maybe... Gervonta's power could get there, maybe, but I don't see it. I think the skills levels are a little bit off, and I give Tevin Farmer the edge. So, after Lomachenko won and mentioned that he'll fight Mikey Garcia tweeted, ready when you are, or something like that, basically.
Yeah, something along those lines.
So, I'll make it happen. I don't remember, but. Basically, the point is, Mikey Garcia will like to fight. I don't see the fight happening.
Say when is what he
said.
Say when.
Oh, yeah. And then basically, Lomachenko said, you know, come to Washington. I'm here, you know. We could fight whenever you want.
Jehovah's Witnesses just came knocking on the door. We told them no. But it's fine. We'll leave it at that. But what were you talking about?
So I don't know exactly where they want to go with the Lomachenko versus Mikey Garcia fight. If it happens, it's not going to fight. be a fight that's going to be max. I'll probably see it like in maybe a year or two from now if it does happen.
It has to be something the fans are demanding.
And Mikey Garcia would have to sign back with Top Rank, which I really doubt.
Or a promotional deal. That's what it is. That's what I'm saying. They want to keep the money in-house.
Exactly. So eventually he has to at least sign for at least three or four fights with Top Rank. So let's see where that goes. But I don't see
it. That was a nasty divorce.
Yep. And talking about, you know, rumors and news, basically, now we are hearing that Triple G is not going to fight Saunders on June 10th.
Like Saunders said that Triple G is scared of him.
Hey, I'm about to go on a rant right now because I'm disappointed.
He's getting on Triple G soapbox. Get him back.
All right, so basically, I'm a Triple G fan, but I'm disappointed. I had Triple G, right? So I'm disgusted, basically, with Triple G, and I'm going to go at it.
He's injured.
My man, Abel Sanchez is your freaking old trainer saying you're not freaking injured. What kind of bullshit is this? And I like boxers are you know, straightforward with your fans. Basically, if you're freaking injured, you just come out and say so. But think about it. Golden Boy say, if you fight Saunders, you're not gonna get the Canelo fight. I'm not about the money. I'm not about this. I'm about getting my belts. You got a chance to get the belts, and you're gonna ruin it to go against Canelo when they're trying to dictate.
They're gonna rob you, man. They're gonna put that 117, 111 jersey ahead of the Lara fight.
Dude, I'm
telling
you. They're
gonna fuck up your shit.
They're gonna ruin you, basically, because you will not go that as a unified, undisputed unified champion because you decided to wait it out and get a money grab. Dude, I mean, are you being true to us, the fans, or are you true, you know, you are all like all other boxers who want the money at the end of the day?
If anybody deserves it, though, I mean, he's had so many consecutive defenses. Yeah. I mean, he kind of.
But don't come
it.
And tell me your fucking whole career that you want to build the belts, and then when you got the chance to get all the belts, you decide to go off
he
for the money.
He was one belt away.
Exactly.
And the guy wanted to fight him.
Exactly. So, can I defend Triple G for that? No, fuck no. I mean, I give a lot of boxers a lot of shit when they do wrong things or go off the way, mm-hmm. or even when they take a layoff, or when they talk a lot of crap and don't back it up. I got to do the same with Triple G.
Was it ever specified what kind of injury he had?
He don't have a fucking injury. A mystery injury. If you have an injury, you'll come out.
My dick hurts.
Yeah, probably his dick hurt. I mean, excuse the language. Basically, if you
he was in the bathroom like this. Come see. He's like, what is it? Abel Sanchez walking around like, he's like, Gennady, what's going on? He's like, Abel, my, it's a little bit, he's like, you know, that's probably what it was, he's got a dick injury, that's what it is. He's got
this
sand in his pussy.
I mean, this is BS, guys, and I'm sorry, I hope YouTube doesn't cut this video out because of our language, but, I mean, how can we support a boxer that's sustained his whole entire career, and I supported him till the end, you know, he's about the belt, not moving up because of the belt, not doing this because of the belt.
Hold on, maybe this may work too. How about, you know, I mean, this is me being naive, but right. Let's say if he does fight Canelo, he beats him, and he gets a shot at the titles. Or do you think they're just going to find a way to rob him?
That's the thing.
It's going to be in Vegas, more than likely.
It's a hard, because it's not even about beating him. What about if Canelo loses to Chavez? Or what about if Canelo get hurt against Chavez? What about if Golden Boy want to do an in-house? Because look at Triple G's numbers right now.
He's not putting the numbers
to say, okay, to even compete so they could say that. For me, Chavez versus Canelo made more pay-per-view numbers than.
It's like chemistry. You can't just say one person does enough numbers when they have the right people put together. Because. Example, Floyd and Berto, they didn't do good, but when you put Floyd and Canelo against some good opposition.
Yeah, but this is the thing. People who so-called Triple G supporters show that they don't really support him when it comes to pay-per-view.
What was Canelo's last fight?
Leon Smith. Which
so this is $300,000, right?
Yeah, $300,000, but that's a guy from casual
from
fan.
Yeah.
New that he's from the UK. Exactly.
Yeah,
so,
people didn't know who he was. So.
Versus Khan, he did around 600. Versus Miguel Cotto, he did around over 900. So think about it. I mean, and Miguel Cotto is a big name. Miguel Cotto by himself, he'll put $400 in himself on pay per views. For the Martinez fight, how much they did? And Martinez was not a big draw either. So and they did like 400 or 500.
Let me look that up. It was Cotto versus Martinez
pay per view numbers. So. You could gauge it, basically. I don't see Canelo Triple G making more numbers.
350.
Exactly.
It's still good, man.
So I don't see Canelo versus Triple G doing more numbers versus a son of a legend, two great Mexicans on the Mexican Independence Day.
So they got their own market.
So it's either Canelo's going to rematch Chavez Jr., or, hey, why not better make Canelo versus Lemieux, who's going to be on the undercard, and have an in-house fight? Why will Golden Boy risk
the Golden Goose
again an outside boxer when they could risk him against Lemieux and still keep the guy
keep
and
the
do
money
a rematch
and keep the and, titles.
And if they lose, they keep a rematch all over again, another in-house fighter for May.
Or dehydrate Lemieux
exactly,
or some shit.
Exactly. Huh? They'll figure something out. I honestly think that K2 are too soft, and I always believe it. Loftus is too freaking soft. I understand you want to work with everybody, but sometimes in this game, you gotta be a bitch. You gotta be
Go Kathy Duva on it.
Exactly. So, basically, man, I'm disappointed with Triple G. I'm sorry. My new guy is Gvozdyk, or Gvozdyk. I'm sorry.
Gvozdyk. Gvozdyk.
So, you wanna move on to what?
Well, let's see. All right, we covered that whole portion. That was part of the rumor mill we said. I think last week we talked about the Pacquiao Horn thing coming up.
Yeah, nobody cares about it.
We didn't forget, guys, we're going to do a separate telecast for the Canelo Chavez fight in Spanish, and hopefully give our discussions in English as well. We're going to, it's May. So I think, obviously, you have the Terrence Crawford Diaz. We'll get into that as well. But I think the Canelo fight is going to be first. Triple G's obviously talked about his negotiations. I feel like I'm missing something.
Over the war, bro. But that's
June 17th. So the rematch was signed. It's gonna be in Vegas, right?
Yep.
So it's gonna be in Las Vegas. Rematch for all the titles. And obviously the way Kovalev has come out, if you look at the interviews on shout out to Fight Hub, they've got a bunch of interviews. He's just been very disrespectful towards Ward. He's like literally like, obviously we told you last week about the tweets, but during the press conference you can tell there's a real disrespect. And I kind of feel it is and it's not, but I think the thing with Ward is that there's been a real it's hard to negotiate with somebody. Like, I think that's what it is. That's what it comes down to. They thought it was going to be easy to do the negotiations, and they found that he's a tough guy to negotiate with. He's not easy to negotiate with. And I think that's probably where Kovalev's anger's from. He probably thought, you know, I gave this guy a title match, which he won, or controversial, so easily, and now he's giving me a hard time to get a rematch. And obviously, you know, as most people know, Ward will fight outside the United States. Recently, there was a report that on Fight Hub that Kathy Lee said that when they asked Ward's camp if they wanted a judge that's not from the United States, they said no, they got to get an advantage as possible. So, I have my predictions for the fight. What do you think is going to play out?
All right, so basically, I've been listening to some of these interviews. Kovalev said that in the first fight, he felt fatigued because he overtrained. After the fifth round, so he got tired and he wasn't feeling himself. Kathy Duva backed him up, saying that 3 weeks before the fight, she went to see him to the mountains because he was a big bear in training and saw him like basically tired. So he said that he's gonna change his training. That he used to do three trainings per day. Now he's only gonna go back to two, which was his regular training schedules basically. One thing that he did say.
You have more power if he has two schedules a day.
Yeah, so one thing that he did said that I didn't agree with. Basically, the boxing boys and Ness, shout out to them, they did an interview with John David Jackson after the Chilemba fight, where John David Jackson said that he did his own training, basically, and he was just there to back him up, but he decided to do his own thing. And we saw the result, and in which Kovalev didn't look more vulnerable and was a bit exposed, and didn't take out the guy how we all supposed to. And we saw my new boy, Vasyl, take out Chilemba on the undercard of Kovalev Ward, and Kovalev wasn't able to do it. He said on an interview with
Ness.
No, not with Ness. I'm talking about Kovalev with Mannix. He said in an interview with Mannix that he does his own training now. That he does his own schedule. The only thing that he does with John David Jackson is the mitt. And I realized that in the fight, John David Jackson wasn't giving him any instruction at all. Like, dude, one thing I noticed in boxing, and I've been following forever, you and your trainer make a team, and your trainer notices your mistake, and he guides
outside,
you. Exactly, and he guides you how to adjust and make changes. If you are sitting like Shumanov, they are thinking that you could, and Shumanov did it against Hopkins.
Yeah, wasn't he somebody training in the hotel room? He's like, housekeeping! 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 Take it out! He's like doing this in the back.
This guy was his own trainer. He had nobody in his corner other than a cut man. Like, if you're trying to do that, I don't see Kovalev winning this fight. Because in the first fight, we saw how the combination of Virgil and Andre Ward.
That worked.
It worked.
But I mean, the thing is,
I still feel that the school of boxing,
as far as the way Virgil Hunter teaches, he's a more defensive type coach. And then Ward is his best student because he teaches him the same way, so it works out. But like you were saying,
You need that combination because the other guys see your mistakes. When you're out there in any sport and you think that you're doing the best and you don't see what you're doing wrong, the other guy could point it out for you, you know, and you need that. You need that corner to do so. And John David Jackson didn't, I didn't notice in the first fight that he gave him no
instructions
for him to adjust or to do better, you know. He was just there, you know, like, supporting him, I guess. But if you don't let John David Jackson do his job, and he's the one saying that, I'm setting my own training camps, et cetera, I just do the mix with him, it's not going to work.
If you're a coach that goes out there and says, hey, man, they always do the slap. Hey, man, you got to let them hands go.
Sometimes you need
your hands are tired.
You need that extra motivation from your coach itself. Sometimes,
I'm your coach. I'm like, hey, man. Hey, look at me. They hit him with the towel. Hey, man, you got to let them hands go. You got to let them go.
It's like needing Teddy Atlas in your corner. You know, you need that
fire. You got to flood the basement.
You need that fireman joke.
Yeah, we fireman.
I believe in this stuff. You know, I study a lot of psychology, and I believe in this stuff. This stuff, sometimes, somebody telling you, giving you a great kind of thing in the corner, sometimes give you the extra boost.
That's one of the reasons I really like Danny Garcia. It's because his dad is his biggest fan. It was a guy like that, bro, he pumps him up so much, he believes everything. It's like, of course you're going to believe your dad. That's, hey, dad, can I leave this building? Son, you do anything you want. You're going to die, but he still did it. That's what I'm saying. He fought Dermot's like, yeah, we'll kick his ass, and it, you know, it was that way. But a lot of times your coach gives you all the motivation, and boxing is mostly mental in it. And if you're mind, you have someone to support you, to believe in you, that you can push yourself. You're going to push yourself, and you know what? Chances are you're going to succeed because, you know, it's hard to perform when, you know, it's just you, yourself, and there. But if someone knows you well, they work with you, they know what you're capable of, you know, and they know you could achieve it, and you believe them, then it'll happen, you know?
So basically, honestly, I'm really sorry. You know that Ward already understand what kind of his boxing, and maybe I'm wrong. You know, maybe Kovalev will catch him with a good punch and knock him out.
I got Kovalev winning.
But
I see Kovalev putting him to sleep.
If that doesn't happen, man, if it goes to the rounds, we're gonna win all over again. If Kovalev doesn't knock him out the first five rounds. He's gonna go all against another decision.
I mean,
and probably people are gonna be right and say that Ward is gonna beat him with a. Because honestly, I think that he should, unless, you know, he should let John David Jackson take over his role as a trainer. I dictate everything. A lot of guys like Manny Pacquiao, you can't even say Roach. When Pacquiao was not listening to Roach, everything was going sour. I mean, you gotta listen to your coach. That's why you have a coach. You would have, boxer would never have a coach.
That's what happens, man. When you can't blame your coach, you blame your shoulder.
That's what Tito Trinidad needed, that slap by his father. Yeah. I mean, things like that motivate a fighter and push him to another limit.
When you can't blame your coach, you blame your shoulder.
Yeah, that's
when you lose.
That's my opinion.
I don't have my shoulder.
I don't know. Maybe I see him better in training, or I don't know. But as of now, I still got war edging him.
I see Kovalev winning by an impressive knockout. He's not going to overtrain, so he's going to have more mustard to his punches. So it's going to be one of those things that got more fans approaching over here. I see Kovalev getting the knockout. But one reason, business aside, obviously, Andre Ward is what, Rock Nation? He's a Rock Nation fighter.
But
their best fighter on their stable. And obviously, Jay-Z is the head of that one. Whoever he's partnering with to do that, that's their best fighter. A fighter like that is very similar, and I'm not saying style similar, but just marketability. It's very similar to a Rigondeaux. Because a lot of people thought, well, Ward was in this contract negotiation with Goose and Promotions, couldn't get out. a lot of people maybe thought, you know what, maybe the Goosen promotions, they weren't able to get him out of his contract. He wasn't able to grow as a fighter. I honestly think Ward has no marketability. One of the reasons it stifles his success, and I get Ward, it's more of a thing of his pride, you know what I'm saying? And the thing is, he's a very reserved guy. He's not going to say much unless he feels the need to say it. I don't know him personally, but I'm just saying from what I've seen from him, he's the type of guy that if he's going to say something because he's certain about what he's saying. But pretty much, he's not a marketable fighter. He has skills, but in boxing, you know, skills do pay the bills. But as far as promoters and they're trying to make money, you need a fighter that has a fan base behind him. And Ward has what? What was it, the Bay? Where are you from?
Yeah, Bay Area.
Bay Area, that's where he's from. He has his fan base there. But outside of that, like, who's really... Yeah, they got him on a pound-for-pound list, but who's really a big Ward fan outside of that? Like, really, there's really no...
I feel
Terrence Crawford has a bigger fan base. Floyd, no question. That's what I'm saying. If you're going to be at that level of greatness, you have to be marketable. You have to connect. You have to have something. And that's what I'm saying. A guy like him is possible. I just don't think... Personality-wise, he has it. That's what I'm saying. I got him, well, if I win fights, no, it's not enough. Because, look, I honestly feel Kovalev is a better guy to hold that belt. And there's more money to be made than to give it to this guy. So, honestly, if it's not by knockout, they're going to find a way to give Kovalev the belt back. I'm telling you, it's going to happen, man. I have Kovalev. If it's not by knockout, it's going to be by decision. I wouldn't be surprised if they rob Ward of the fight.
They're not going to rob the gold medalist. I mean, they gave him the belt the first time. And
well, I think they had expectations of him to generate more money to the sport. But the thing is,
he won the Super 6.
But here's the thing, though. This is one thing I want to point out. When Ward beat Kovalev, and this is the thing. When you're a great fighter, when you're a good fighter, it's like anything else. When you're good at your craft, oh, he was nothing. They're going to bring someone else to put him against. Ward has won that fight, and aside from Kovalev, is there anyone else you would want to see Ward fighting? Be honest. Like, honestly, I don't. A guy like Kovalev, I can see him fight anyone, but Ward, he doesn't generate that interest, I think. I'm not taking away his skill. He's very skilled. But as far as interest, as far as to sell, to make money, he doesn't generate that interest.
Yeah, but we already saw that HBO doesn't run the show. And if HBO would have run the show, Kovalev would have gotten the decision like we all believe he won. But basically, what we Americans are greedy, and we want our guys to be successful. The last gold medalist to become... two-time world champion, and be pound for pound. Right now, you just saw they just put him on pound for pound number one, and they just gonna start trying to build him up as much as possible. And he's been I'm not gonna front. He's been talking a little bit more, and the same way you're bringing it up. I mean, I feel the same way when you are a boxer and you are not being up and forward with your fans, you want to support the guy, and I don't blame you guys. That's why I just said, Triple G, man, I'm mad at you right now, because dude, you're fucking up basically, and that's the sport of boxing. If you're not communicating with your fans, you're not gonna gain any support, and that's why as much as HBO wanted to support him and put him up and give him all this money to buy fight basically bums, he wasn't not generating his numbers. He was doing like 300k views per fight, while other guys are doing 1.2 million. I mean, on HBO. The guy was not getting the support that he needed to be a star. And a guy like Jacobs before the Triple G fight said, I don't understand why I'm not getting the support, because you're not selling
yourself. He's a likable guy. I could see him, but in a loss. He says a lot about him.
He's not selling himself. He's not. In boxing, you either need the super nice guy never get the support. Look at Triple G. I mean, you gotta be a villain.
Be the villain, yeah.
You gotta become somehow the fancy guy that everybody.
That's how Mayweather built his career.
Exactly, because everybody in the hood, like we are from, want to come up and see, oh, yo, we can make it too, and we want to support this guy. You know, he's from the hood. He came down from the bottom. Now he's here. He's doing the thing, and that's what we support.
Despite all of Broner's losses, that's one of the things that keeps him still relevant, is that he can sell a fight.
Exactly, because he's a talker. You know, you can't just be the humble guy who beat cancer. You know, that itself is not gonna. Yeah, we were there in the arena. No, This guy had nobody there. Jacob had no supporters.
Probably the fans on Hoyt and Skimmer.
Nobody showed up to support him. Nobody put our money out of their pocket. We supported Triple G. I mean, we went out there. We bought our ticket to support the guy. Now he let me down, and I want my money back, son. Yo, sign me a check, Lawford.
No, I see it. As far as that fight, I have Kovalev winning. So, is there anything else for this week that you could think of?
As of right now, you know, just that's it for rumors. I know, you know, Gabriel Rosado is gonna fight.
Oh yeah, Martin Murray.
Martin Murray soon. We just heard about.
It's gonna make it a Ward Gotti type style thing. I don't know.
I mean,
I think he says his last attempt to add a belt.
What kind of belt? That's a. That belt mean nothing, but we support.
I like it, Rosado.
Yeah,
he's a very exciting fighter.
Rosado, yeah, he's a kid who showed a lot of heart, and like he said on back again and shouting out Ness and the Boxing Boys, they did a really nice interview. If y'all haven't heard, check it out. It's really nice. And he said it. This guy he never took a break. He never took a soft fight. He went from the best guy to the best guy to the best guy.
Yeah, no breaks. I mean, look at his record. He went Quillen, Triple G. Lemieux,
Charlo's,
Monroe. If you look at, I could pull it up right now. You look at his record, it looks like, man, this guy has fought the best guy. Obviously, he's come up short, but still, it shows that you're not being, you know, coddled.
And for me, he was winning the Peter Quillen fight. You know, he gave Triple G a great fight, man. That was a great. People were saying, oh, Triple G was sick, yeah, but he still gave him a great fight.
Yeah, look, he has 23 wins, Gabriel Rosado. Out of those 23, 13 KOs, 10 losses. You're like, wow, who's this guy with 4 knockouts? But one thing about Rosado, those knockouts are not that he's been laid flat. Those knockouts have been due to his eye that always opens up. So Gabriel Rosado.